Okay, can I have your attention? That was a very efficient lunch getting, so thank you for doing that. I'm Marianne Wanamaker, Executive Director at the Baker Center here on campus. Our mission is sound policy, thoughtful leadership, and informed citizens, so thanks for being part of that today. We are partnering today with the Boyd Center for Business and Economic Research here on campus and with Tennessee Achieves, and I want to thank them for their efforts in helping us bring together these two pieces of today, and I'll talk more about the schedule in a little bit. But first, it's my pleasure to introduce a man who really needs no introduction. President Boyd is going to introduce the whole event today, and if you know Randy, you know that his Twitter feed is active, and so I heard this morning he's been at 9 commencements over the past 2 days, and so I was counting on Twitter. I wasn't all the way to 9, but really close, and he's lost his voice, so we'll turn the mic up, and if you'll welcome Randy Boyd.
Thank you, Marianne. This is kind of like what I said at the commencements. Nobody really came to hear me speak. I think the same thing is true for today. We're here to hear from the Boyd Center and from then our panelists a bit in the future. But again, thinking about doing the commencements, it's so inspirational to shake all those hands. I will get to shake about 3,000 hands over the last 9 days. UT graduated 8,417 students over the last 9 days statewide. And it's so meaningful to be in that moment with that student crossing that stage and knowing how it's the biggest moment in the entire life. But as I'm thinking about this meeting today, if we can't figure out the problems that are before us, there'll be fewer coming across the stage than more. So I'm excited about the work that we're going to do today. And just looking around the room, we've got everybody that we need to have at the table to solve this. So thank you all for being here. I want to thank Marianne Wanamaker and the Baker Center for hosting us and allowing us to use this great facility. I want to thank the Boyd Center for, and I think you're going to introduce the folks that are going to speak, for the great research that they've done and that they'll be sharing with you. And I'm going to also want to thank just my former boss. He's not here yet. Governor Haslam will be showing up eventually, but to be also being our moderator with the panelists that we have. There'll be a lot of great conversation. I think there'll be some information that will be new to you. Many of you already know about the dramatic drop in college going rate. When we first started Tennessee Promise, we were at 65% that year. This year, we're down to 52%, and we're going in the wrong direction very fast. But our state likes a challenge, and this is definitely the challenge of our time. And I'm looking forward to not only getting a lot of information today, but also coming up with some great solutions as well. So with that, I want to turn it back over to Marianne to introduce our first couple of speakers.
Okay, let me first give you a little bit of a timeline. So the first hour, we're going to hear from Celeste Carruthers and Stephen Gentile. I'll introduce them in just a second. And then at the end of that hour, we're going to give you a substantial little break and get reset. And then the panel discussion that you see in front of you with these nameplates will start at 1 o'clock and end at 2 o'clock. At any point today, you can stop at this table outside the doors and grab a parking voucher. So if you parked in one of the garages, make sure you do that. So let me introduce our first two presenters. Celeste Carruthers is the William Fox Distinguished Professor of Labor Economics in the Haslam College of Business. She has a joint appointment in the Department of Economics and the Boyd Center for Business and Economic Research. She is the university's foremost expert in education policy, in particular in the labor market implications of education policy. And she has crossovers in public economics, labor economics, and economic history. And our second presenter is Dr. Stephen Gentile. And Dr. Gentile is the Chief Policy Officer at TEHEC, where he oversees the Bureau of Policy Planning and Research. And the Bureau is charged with researching and developing policies and practices that make earning a higher education credential more attainable. TEHEC's press release and accompanying report this morning on college going in the state of Tennessee are a prime example of that work. So please welcome Drs. Carruthers and Gentile to the podium.
All right. Good afternoon right now. Central time, it is morning. So Dr. Carruthers and I switch things up a little bit. I'll go first in my presentation today. Today we're going to go over some facts that we see in our overall college going rate. And I'll talk about what that is in a second. And then discuss, of course, always I have problems with that. Hold on a second, guys. We're going to spend the first 20 minutes figuring this out, and then we'll go from there. Here we go. There we go. Great. Thank you. All right. Now that we figured this out, we can figure out college access in Tennessee. We're going to go over, for the next about 40 minutes, provide some data, think through some hypotheses about why we have the decline in college enrollment, and think through also what this means for Tennessee overall. We do welcome clarifying questions as we move forward, though we also hope to have about 10, 15 minutes at the end for general question and answer session. Dr. Carruthers and I are about to throw lots of data at you. For that, I apologize. I will watch for eyes glazing over if I'm going too far deep into it, and I'll bring up the plane just a little bit to just hit the salient points where necessary. But I do want to provide some context behind the data. When we talked and were invited to make this presentation, I could speak on behalf of TEHEC and speaking to my colleagues. We are certainly in this period of uncertainty when it comes to college access and trying to figure out what's happened over the last 2 years and then projecting forward the next 10, 15 years. That's where we are right now when it comes to college access. My colleagues here, we talk about this a lot. My four-year-old son, his experience in daycare is vastly different from when his sister went through it just 2.5 years ago. All the way from dropping him off at school, not being there to see him write his name in, to see how he's doing with writing, and so on. Think through the accretion of those type of activities over the pipeline of K-12 education and try to determine how that will impact college enrollment in the future is where we are right now. Perfect, thank you. So this morning, we released our TEHEC College Going report and paired that with our high school senior opinion survey. This report looks at the graduating class of the spring 2021, so a year ago, and looks to see where they enrolled. We also surveyed a sample of this population a year ago to ask them what their aspirations for college were. And so this presentation here will pair it. So what is the college going rate? The college going rate, as we're measuring it, is looking at for students who started off in the ninth grade cohort at a public high school. And then, senior year, of that ninth grade cohort at the public high school, the group that graduates, that is our denominator. We're looking to track that pool of students. With our own student information system and also leaning heavily into the National Student Clearinghouse student tracker data, we can see where these high school graduates, if they go to college, and where they go to college. We can track them in Tennessee to all of our public sectors. Through the clearinghouse, we can also track to see if they're going in-state or out-of-state, public and private. As President Boyd mentioned, with Tennessee Promise, college going rate got up to 64-65%. And then over time, so that was a leap from 58.6% to 64.4%. Over time, between 2015 and 2019, that rate dwindled a little bit. And we were concerned about that. But we also recognized that we were going up against the strongest economy that had been around since before the Great Recession. That's really when the economy, the United States economy and Tennessee's economy, was starting to hum along. And so competing with the workforce is a constant constant hurdle to go through with higher education. But then in that first year of the pandemic, college going rate declined from 61.8% down to 56.8%. And then this past year, dropped again to 52.8%. I want to apologize for not giving you some data context here. That lower circle there, the high school graduates, from year to year, it's about 60,000 to 65,000 students that we're looking at. So that decline from 61.8% down to 52.8%, that difference in rate means about 7,000 students per year fewer going to college. They're not showing up anywhere. What do we know about those students who are going somewhere? First, the rate of students going to an in-state public institution has declined from 76.4% to 74.4%, from a high of 78.4% in 2017, but pre-pandemic to post-pandemic, or where we are right now, 76.4% to 74.4%. The total number of students going to in-state public schools has greatly reduced, and not just because the college-going cohort has reduced, so has those going to in-state public. We can get a glimpse when we start thinking about hypotheses of where students are going. Between 2019 and 2021, the rate of students going to an out-of-state public school increased from 7.8% to 9.3%. Even with that in count down there plummeting from 39.5 thousand to 33,000, those numbers going to college, the actual percentage of students, the actual number of students going to an out-of-state public has held steady at about 3,000 students per year from this cohort. That did not decline in count, in total number of students. It suggests perhaps those that were most impacted by the pandemic and enrolling in college were those who were probably less likely to enter college to begin with, maybe could not afford college, or think that they want to go and put the expenses up on the front end. Those students going to out-of-state public and out-of-state private has also grown. Perhaps the impact of the pandemic was less likely to change what they were going to do with the pandemic. So take that bottom square right there and zero in even further. And we look at those who are going in-state public. We know that fewer of them, much, much fewer, are going to a community college. From right before the pandemic, 2019, 46.3% of all students going to an in-state college went to a community college. And in 2021, just 43%. And that is from a great decline from 48% in 2017. There has been increases in the LGIs, locally governed institutions. That top bright blue bar has gone up over that time. And also University of Tennessee has gone up as well as a relative share. In actuality, the total number of students going to any of these universities as a whole has also declined, but their share has increased due to that great drop in the community college sector. Zeroing in on the East region now, the East Grand Division, we were able to see of this cohort that was going off to college where they were going. Looking at TCATS specifically, 38.1% of all students who go to a TCAT from that graduating senior class is going to a TCAT in this division. That stands out to me for one big reason. One is that that middle region, the middle grand division, is actually the largest share of students in Tennessee who are going to college. About 43% of students who are going to college are from the middle division. But the East Grand Division outpaces both divisions and sending students to TCATs. If you look at the total number of students from that graduating cohort going to TCATs, where they're going, it's not surprising that Chattanooga and Knoxville lead the way as the population centers in the East, 117 and 110 respectively going on to those TCATs. But Morristown also stands out to me at 109. In preparation for this presentation, when I saw this data, I reached out to two of our individuals in our office, Brandon Hudson and Mitch Curry, to ask, do we know what's going on here at Morristown? And their suggestion was, well, it's probably due to GIVE 1.0, GIVE 2.0, SPARK, acronyms that reflect the governor's investment in vocational education, in our TCATs, in investing in dual enrollment, SPARK as well, SPARK supporting post-secondary access in our rural communities, where we are putting opportunities at TCAT Morristown for students in high school to directly engage with that TCAT. And perhaps, correlationally, we're seeing that that is driving enrollment at Morristown. Looking at overall first-time, full-time freshmen at all of our community colleges, all six here in the East, as well as ETSU, UT Chattanooga, UT Knoxville, from fall 2017 to fall 2021, we see at all of our institutions a notable decline in first-time, full-time freshmen. That holds true at the community colleges, ETSU, UT Chattanooga. It's not true at UT Knoxville. UT Knoxville has had a great increase in the students who are going to that institution. I want to highlight this here for two reasons. One, UT Knoxville is able to lean more into getting students from out of state. That relative percentage has increased over time. But also, this is true in every state with their flagship. If they're hurting on enrollment or the projections are looking not good, they can increase their enrollment easily, being a more selective institution, whereas other institutions are less likely to do so or have that capability. That's notable when Dr. Carruthers was talking about the demographic cliff at the end of the presentation. As fewer and fewer high school students are coming of age to go to college, that might mean more of a serious issue for our regional education institutions and less so for our flagship. Our CGR, college-going rate by all counties here. This map here shows in each of the counties that college-going rate. Again, for all of Tennessee, it's 52.8%. The darker the county, the higher the college-going rate. The lighter the county, the lower the college-going rate. 63 counties of our 95 are below the average of 52.8. The lowest is Fayette County out west at 33%. The highest is 81% at Williamson County. I'll focus on the east region here in a second. Shelby and Davidson County are just under 50%. When dividing this up into different divisions, the red, the bright red, I bucked the color scheme here so that the east would stand out here. The bright red is East Tennessee. From left to right, you've got the state, the West Division, Middle Division, East Division. College-going rates across the state in all of our grand divisions have plummeted. What stands out to me is that in 2017, the college-going rate for East Tennessee was the lowest of the three grand divisions, 62.5%. It trailed Middle Tennessee by 2 percentage points. Now in 2021, it is still very low. It's plummeted. That's not good news. Silver lining is that it's now above the average and is closer within 5/10 to Middle Tennessee. West Tennessee has had a great drop in college going, driven largely by Shelby County, although Shelby County is actually performing on average in West Tennessee. We're looking at the data. Now, that same map that we showed earlier, just focusing on East Tennessee here. I want you all to know that I crammed my Tennessee geography test yesterday, so we'll see how well I do right here. But the highest one here is Unicoi County, 62.5%. Sullivan County at 61.5%. Knox County at 59.5%. And then Bradley County down here. Is that right, Bradley County? Bradley County's in there now. Okay, great. Thank you. 59.1%. And I'll show you in the next slide the changes over that five-year period. The lowest is Union County at 34.6, Granger at 35.9%. I might have a story to show you on the next slide. And then Bledsoe at 35.2%. Some of the counties that have very high percentages, so Unicoi and Sullivan, they also have lower bases. More so Unicoi has a lower base, about 150 students there in that cohort. So they are likely to have greater swings in data. And this is the five-year change. There are three counties up there. Those three counties are Johnson at 7.1, Polk at 1.8, and another county that I'm forgetting the name of at the very top is 0.3. Those are the only three counties in East Tennessee that had positive growth in college going. Sorry? Campbell, thank you. I had a C started out. I appreciate it. Thank you for the point. Those are the only three counties that had positive growth over the 5 years in college going rate. We have a great team at THEC with a lot of us doing many different things. And when we were looking at this data, my first step was to email Sam Guter, our Chief of Access and Success Policy Officer, as well as Troy Grant, who heads up several of our access-oriented programs. These three counties, all of them have GEAR UP. GEAR UP is a nice long acronym. That's a federal-funded program run through THEC to increase the amount of students who are going to college, who are ready for college. We've had great increases in college going rate in Johnson County and above zero, which in this data is a big winning story. Granger is down 26.2%. We don't know the direct cause of it. What we do know is that under the previous iteration of GEAR UP, it's a limited, time-limited federal grant program. Over the previous iteration that ended in 2018, that county's college going rate exploded with GEAR UP. In fact, it got so high that they no longer qualified for a second iteration of GEAR UP. And what GEAR UP does, GEAR UP tracks a specific cohort from middle school forward to be sure that they are college ready, but also every senior class in that high school, when they get to it, have zeroed in attention on going to college. And so does the GEAR UP stepping away from that county, is that leading to that plummeting of college going? We're unsure. But it definitely has us asking more questions about the level of support we give counties and what we can and should be doing for counties moving forward. Still focused on the East, looking at disparities by race. That top blue line, this is not all students, but it's a majority of our students. The top blue line is all of our white students. And college going rate has declined from 62.1 to 55.2, very much mirroring the average. The vast majority of the students are white. But looking at black and Hispanic students, black being the light blue, going from 61% to 53.3%. Hispanics going from 47% to 37%. Those are declines of 8 percentage points, 10 percentage points, respectively. The gaps between them and white students have expanded greatly during this time. And this is looking at females and males. Males are traditionally much lower than females. That has persisted here with the declines. For females over this time period, declining by 7 percentage points. Males declining by nearly 8 percentage points over that same time frame. What's interesting to me and sad is that females, though they have declined to 59.2%, they're still higher than where males were before the pandemic. Now males are well below 50% on college going. Thank you for surviving the data spray at you right now. I now want to pair this briefly to our high school senior opinion survey, and then I'll hand it off to Dr. Carruthers. So again, the same cohort we surveyed back in the spring of last year, high schools across the state, 103 public high schools participated. We had over 5,000 responses. We asked them about their plans for fall following graduation, their knowledge of the college going process, financial aid. We can't say that this survey yielded a sample that is completely representative of the population, but we feel pretty confident that we can highlight for you results that will still make you scratch your head. Number one, we asked them, hey, before this pandemic and now where we are, what were your plans for going to college? That top bar shows it. Nearly 70% before the pandemic intended to directly enroll in college following graduation. That just declined by a percentage point. Those that wanted to take time off and then enroll declined by a percentage point. So that is definitely a shift that we see. But still, nearly 70% of that class said they wanted to go to college. And the college going rate is actually 52.8%. This is very parallel with literature that shows that people, especially their high school senior year, anticipate going to college directly afterward, but a much lower share do not. What this tells me is that that college going rate plummeted, and yet there is a great amount of students out there who do actually want to go to college and intend to be 18, 19 years old in college. So what do we need to do to help them get back into college? What does that look like? When asked, what is your first institution you want to go to? If money is not an option, this is the list. I'll just boil it down quickly to you, for you guys. Those wanting to go to a four-year institution, in-state, out-of-state, public, private, was about 65% of students had one of the four-year type of institutions as their top choice. And 9.2 had TCAT, 8.8 had a community college. This is important to me because we've got fantastic financial aid opportunities for our for community college students and TCAT students. We need to be mindful of that when we're implementing policies and practices to help them start off at those colleges and then segue into the four-year university if that's what they want to do. Because apparently, a great majority of them do want to go to a four-year college if money is not an option. But regards to money, how are we doing as a state in getting financial aid information out to our students? Successes. Nearly 100% of our students have familiarity with Tennessee Promise due to the great work of many in this room. Hope Scholarship, our lottery scholarship, our merit-based scholarship, 80% have familiarity. That is a saliency level that is very high and is great for our two flagship scholarships. Opportunities, maybe. Nearly half had no familiarity with the federal Pell Grants. And over half had no familiarity with the Tennessee Student Assistance Award. That's the state's need-based aid grant. I put a maybe on there because this is the genius of Tennessee Promise. We know that students have a hard time digesting what the Pell Grants are, what the need-based aid grants are, what the applications are. And that's why we point them to Promise and say, look, we promise you college is going to be, tuition is going to be free for you. Go through this process. So them knowing the intricacies of the Pell Grant or TSAA, perhaps that's the whole point of Tennessee Promise. But for those students who don't directly enroll, knowing that these are opportunities is important for them. And for our last big finding here, definite opportunities. Over 80% of our students had no familiarity with the Wilder-Nafe Technical Skills Grant, a $2,000 per year scholarship to go to a TCAT. And they can get that even if they don't directly enroll coming out of high school. So age 19, age 20, well before Tennessee Reconnect is available to them at age 23, another tuition-free program, they could get a grant that gets them into that TCAT. And nearly half of students had no familiarity with work study. For those students who are itching to work while going to school, knowing that there's something at the school that might be able to meet their needs. Now, there's a very low take-up rate of work study to begin with, so there's a whole bunch of barriers to take on there. But still, maybe we have opportunities to tell more about other options for financial aid. So from our THEC lens, and I've got two colleagues here from THEC, Amanda Clefane, our Senior Director of Research and Strategy, Lou Hanneman, our Chief of Staff as well. What does this have us thinking about? First, declining enrollment may yield lower outcomes. Our state appropriation funding formula is fueled not by enrollment, but by outcomes. And I say it may yield lower outcomes, there's a chance that we have better throughputs, retention rates, graduation rates with a lower enrollment. But what we know is that retention is down right now during this pandemic in the university sector and in the community college sector. Down greatly in the university sector, 82.6%, down to 78.3%. Some hypotheses here, perhaps the students who started in fall of 2020 did not have a great experience having a lot of their classes, say, virtually. So fewer of them came back. Maybe this is a short-lived problem. Hopefully it is, but may not be. Starting tomorrow, THEC, with our Access and Success team, are convening a lot of our partnering organizations, community-based organizations from across the state. We're going to have this very similar presentation, and we're going to start asking questions. What can we be doing as a state? What do we need to be doing? What questions do we need to be asking? What policies do we need to propose? We know that we need to continue supporting our institutions. Community college sector, plummeting enrollment, have much lower tuition revenue right now. We need to continue, getting a big nod from President Wise right here, he can attest. We need to continue supporting our institutions to be able to have, like we did just last week, voted in a 0% increase in tuition. We want to maintain affordability. We want to maintain our success practices. So this is what we'll be doing and going forward. Thank you. Dr. Carruthers?
Thank you, Stephen. So what I would like to do now is zoom out a bit from first-time college students coming straight out of high school to all post-secondary students in Tennessee and also in the United States, because the enrollment patterns that Stephen talked about for Tennessee high school graduates are not unique to Tennessee, and they're not unique to new high school graduates. So in Tennessee, total college enrollment looking across all sectors, public, private, two-year, and four-year, boomed during and shortly after the Great Recession, fluctuated and plateaued throughout the 2010s before falling noticeably in fall 2020, both in Tennessee and in the United States. Every student group, with one exception at the bottom, saw lower college enrollment rates in fall 2020. First-time students, 5.5% fewer in Tennessee, 8.8% fewer throughout the rest of the U.S. Continuing and transfer students also fell by 2.5%. Non-degree students, which includes dual-enrolled high school students, fell 6.6% in Tennessee and elsewhere in the U.S. The exception is graduate and professional students, whose enrollment ticked up by 4 or 2% in Tennessee and elsewhere throughout the U.S. So the enrollment boom during and after the Great Recession was driven by students going to community colleges and TCATs throughout Tennessee. And likewise, at the other end, in fall 2020, the steep enrollment decline was much more potent among two-year college students in Tennessee. Looking ahead to fall 2021, enrollment across almost all the community college campuses was also substantially lower, down 7% from fall 2020 enrollment, which itself was down 10% from 2019. TCATs are a little bit of a different story here. As of fall 2020, TCAT enrollment across most of the campuses was lower than it had been in fall 2019, but enrollment recovered and bounced back really quickly in TCATs across the state. So if we look at the full academic year, fall 2020 and into the 2021 academic terms, TCAT total headcount was actually up 3%, and it has continued to climb in fall 2016. So in terms of persistence and completion, what we're seeing in Tennessee is very similar to what's happening nationwide. So we're looking at this in this figure, and this is nationwide data from the National Student Clearinghouse, and what it's saying is that out of 100 students who start college in a given year, about 74 or 75 of them return for their second year of college the next year. That's that dashed line going across the middle of the graph. And that first to second year persistence rate noticeably ticked down from about 76% to 74% with the class who started college in 2019. So they did not come back for fall 2020. We see the same kind of persistence declines happening in Tennessee institutions. So far, the six-year college completion rate, so that's the percent of students among those 100 who earn a certificate, an associate's or a bachelor's degree within 6 years of starting college. So far nationwide, the six-year completion rate has not ticked down. In fact, it ticked up among the students who would have been affected by COVID at the end of that six-year window. So the students who started in 2014 or 2015 saw somewhat higher college completion rates. But that graduation rate might start to fall given what we're seeing with first to second year persistence. as we look to more recent cohorts. So what I'd like to do now is collect a few hypotheses or reasons why college going and enrollment are following. And just keep in mind that some of these are going to be a bigger part of the story for fall 2020 enrollment and academic year 2021 enrollment than they are or they were for this current 21-22 academic year enrollment. And of course, the situation remains in flux, as does like the salience of these different factors. So the first factor to discuss is online learning. So in the best circumstances and in the best of times, online learning and online programs can be a great way to expand access to college and to higher education and kind of allow people who can't otherwise get to campus for weekly lectures to attain a certificate or a degree. But it's not for every student, and online learning is not for every program. Like, we hear from students that the online learning experience was kind of an imperfect substitute for being in the class, and abundant research, much of it conducted during and after COVID online disruptions, have found that students do worse in online classes. They're less likely to persist, they get lower grades. So student aversion to online learning is well-founded in some regards, and it may have kept some students kind of away from college, especially in fall 2020 and into 2021. Online learning is also impractical for some programs. So focusing on that hypothesis, some researchers at Northwestern University and University of Virginia have posed the idea that, you know, in some programs, they focused on assembly, repair, and maintenance programs in community colleges across seven states. Tennessee was one of them. Like, supply constraints during the pandemic required by the social distancing and new sanitation measures and things like that may have led these programs to be able to like serve fewer students. And that could explain part of the contraction in enrollment. So they didn't include TCATs in their sample, but they did have Tennessee community colleges as well as community colleges from six other states. And they found some support for this hypothesis. So community college programs that had a bigger footprint occupied by assembly, repair, and maintenance programs prior to the pandemic saw larger contractions in enrollment as of fall 2020. It didn't explain the entire contraction, but it explained a significant share of it. Something worth noting, though, is that in Tennessee, we had relatively less campuses that were fully or primarily online than the rest of the US. So these statistics come from the College Crisis Initiative based out of Davidson College in North Carolina. I believe that was Davidson, he's an alumnus. And so their team kind of surveyed the reopening policies across in fall 2020 and spring 2021 across campuses throughout the United States, and they have this great dashboard where you can dig in. And what we found when we dug into that dashboard is that in Tennessee, relatively high share of the campuses, both public and private, that they had kind of surveyed were full or primarily in person compared to kind of a lower share across the rest of the United States as a whole. And Tennessee had fewer campuses that were full or primarily online. So aversion to online learning is probably part of the story of the enrollment decline, but it was maybe a smaller part of the story in Tennessee where that was like less pronounced. I also want to add some aversion to in-person learning. While the preponderance of online learning may have kept some students away from college, going to have some other students who would rather not go to class and bear the health risks of catching or spreading COVID, particularly given what we knew, which was relatively little, in 2020-2021. Okay, so can't satisfy everyone under these circumstances. And some stayed away from online classes and some probably stayed away from face-to-face classes. Next, I'd like to talk about the cost of college. So a recent survey found that 60% of adults stated that or responded that they believed a college degree is worth the time and money involved. It's actually not too different from that six-year college completion rate that the NSC is tracking, although it is really interesting that 87% of employers responded affirmatively to that same question. They believe that a college degree is worth the time and money involved. while I appreciate that the cost of college is like much more front of mind than it was 15 or 20 years ago, we hear a lot more about like the student debt crisis and students with like unbearable weight of student loans, things like that. What is less well known is that the cost of college has been flat or falling for several years. So this is data from the College Board. And what we're looking at here in the solid lines is the posted tuition and required fees at two-year public schools nationwide and at four-year public schools nationwide. And so this is going to be one of the first numbers that students find when they try to identify how much it's going to cost to go to a particular college. Okay? What is harder to learn is what they'll actually pay to go to a particular college, and that average is depicted here in dashed line for two-year schools and for four-year schools. And the difference is accounted for by grants and scholarships that students can apply towards tuition. So in two-year public schools, the net price of tuition and required fees has been zero, or actually less than zero, since 2016, 2017 nationwide. And at four-year public schools, the net price, the net tuition, has been closer to $2,000, which is considerably less than the $11,000 average posted tuition and fees. So this is less salient to folks when they're worried about the cost of college, because it takes several months for a student to figure out what exactly their personalized net price of college is going to be. And that's one part of the strength of Tennessee Promise, as Stephen kind of alluded to earlier, is that the free community college message kind of cuts through a lot of this color, of this clutter, and cuts through a lot of the time necessary to determine what the tuition and fee price of college is going to be. Of course, there are other costs of going to college. There are books and supplies, and you might need to change your living situation in a way that's going to be more expensive, childcare, things like that. These same trends for the net cost of attendance have also been flat or falling for several years as well. And then finally, I want to discuss, or almost finally, I want to discuss labor market volatility, rising wages, rising job opportunities for people with no college education, and relaxed education requirements. So one of the big parts of the payoff to a college degree is that it gives you access to jobs that require a college degree, but several employers, both public and private, are relaxing those college degree requirements. It's been an ongoing trend since before the pandemic. So currently, there are more jobs than job seekers. Local companies are recruiting directly from high school. This is a story about Malibu boats. Burger King over on North Shore was offering a $1,200 signing bonus. Big firms are increasing their minimum hourly starting wage in the tightest labor markets to try to attract workers in places where it's hard to find them. And Walmart is raising the salary for trucking, where it's been particularly hard to find workers. So this figure is from the Upjohn Institute and their New Hires Quality Index. There's a lot to process here, but what this is basically tracking is the percent of a population with a given amount of education, high school graduate, bachelor's degree, or graduate degree, that are getting new jobs and getting hired into new jobs relative to the share of them that were getting new jobs in 2005. That's what's indexed to. And basically, that trend was favoring students or workers with a graduate degree through much of the 2010s until 2020. And then kind of this index started favoring high school graduates. So relative to their population, high school graduates were getting more new jobs over the last 2 years. So there's a lot of good news for people without college that are looking to get into work. There are more job opportunities. The wages are going up. The salaries are going up. It is not, however, all good news, because while these indicators are rising, so are prices. So paychecks may be increasing, but it's not necessarily the case that that paycheck gets you more at the grocery store, at the gas station, or the leasing office, three areas where we've seen prices go up steeply. And then finally, I'll add to this incomplete list of why college enrollment might be falling: time constraints, childcare, overall uncertainty about the economy, about what the labor market is going to value in the future. There's a lot of fluctuation happening in these different domains. For many people and many students, college is like a very complicated daily game of Tetris that's constantly changing. To move all the pieces around to make them fit. And the pandemic and the ensuing fallout just completely changed the game and led it to crash a lot too at the same time. So what does falling post-secondary enrollment mean for Tennessee and for Tennesseans? So I'm in the economics department. Our default straw man model of decision making is that given enough information about the relative trade-offs, people know what they're doing. They make the best decision that they can given their resources. So that best decision might not be the best in the long term, particularly if they don't have great information about the long-term trade-offs. And those resources might be a little more constrained than they need to be from society's perspective. So to the question, like, is college still worth the cost? I'm going to go out on a limb with this group. I've seen the RSVP list and say, yes, I think so. College is still worth the cost. On average, I'll come back to the average part in the next slide. So the New York Federal Reserve estimates a 14% return on investment. College graduates earn a lot more in nominal terms, and they have lower unemployment rates than people with just a high school diploma. The median bachelor's degree has a $306,000 net return on investment, according to one analysis. Only one in five jobs earning at least $45,000 by age 45, so a pretty minimal level of financial security, particularly for a family, go to individuals without a college education, according to Georgetown. So these are correlations, you might be saying, if you had taken my graduate econometrics class. Well, you would learn midway through the semester that researchers have looked at circumstances where they can identify students on the margin of going to college, where by virtue of good luck on a test day, some students went to college, and by virtue of bad luck on a test day, some students did not, or by virtue of living a little closer to a community college, some students went to college and some did not. And when they compare these college goers to these marginal non-college goers, they find that the students who went to college are earning 18 or 22% more by age 30. So it's really compelling quasi-experimental evidence that college is still a really good deal for students. But I want to emphasize that average returns are not guarantees. If college is an investment, it does not always pay off. It doesn't pay off for every student, and it doesn't pay off for every program on average. So that same study I cited earlier, this bachelor's ROI falls considerably after accounting for the risk of dropping out in their model. College, but especially major, play a really big role. There are a lot of programs that this analyst estimates have a negative ROI once you factor in the risk of dropping out. And even if a student pays nothing to attend, so they have no tuition bill and they can kind of live with family or live with a partner, there's a 22% chance that college does not pay off simply in terms of the kind of wage benefits as well. There's lots of non-wage health and family and societal benefits that are here in the background but are really hard to quantify, but should be part of our calculus here. And many will need loans to afford college. About one in five student loan borrowers are in default. You can't discharge your student loan in bankruptcy. Being in default on your student loan has serious consequences for your credit, for future financial aid, even for your take-home pay. And as noted earlier, some public and private employers are dropping college education requirements, which does change the calculus for high school graduates who are kind of thinking about getting into higher paying entry-level work. So I'll close by bucketing some of these factors for falling enrollment into three categories. Call them interruptions, which are pandemic-fueled hurdles to enrolling in college. And once the pandemic is fully under control in folks' minds, hopefully these will be less of a factor. Widespread online and hybrid learning is not as necessary as it was a year and a half ago. We hope that the health risks from in-person learning can fade away. And inconsistent childcare, which is going to be a big factor for older students, will hopefully get resolved as soon as the youngest kids can get vaccines and childcare labor shortages are alleviated. Disruptions are also attributed to the pandemic, but they may be with us longer, even if these interruption factors can be kind of healed. Worker shortages, economists are projecting a tight labor market for a little while to come. And along with that, possibly, depending on Fed work, rising nominal wages for high school graduates that make work very attractive over college. Transformation or ongoing pre-pandemic changes in the expected cost and payoff of going to college, including changing sentiment about the cost and value of college, structural resets to these education requirements, an aging United States, there's going to be a lot fewer 18 to 22-year-olds in a short amount of time. Labor-saving automation, on the other side, historically has kind of substituted for jobs that don't rely on college-educated workers. And so as this labor-saving automation continues apace, some of the folks who opted to delay college may down the road kind of find that their kind of high-paying new jobs have been kind of automated or substituted with new capital. And then finally, local, state, and federal policy around college affordability is going to be a factor in this and going forward. But across these three different buckets, you'll have some students, both young and older, who have delayed or deferred college, who may change their minds in the future when the interruptions kind of fade away, or if these rising nominal wages and worker shortages kind of go back to what they looked like in 2018, 2019. And if they can change their mind about the sentiment or change their mind about the cost and the value of higher education. So none of these factors are permanent, even for the students who, as Stephen showed, opted not to go to college in the last couple of years. Thank you. Okay. So we have 5 minutes or so. Okay. 5 minutes or so for kind of open Q&A for either Stephen or I. We solved it.
So, a question for Dr. Gentile. TEC's been running the high school surveys of college aspirations for decades. The questions on intent to enroll, how have those questions changed over time?
That's an excellent question. I'm going to look actually to Amanda Clefane. Amanda, she's the one who is behind all of this as our senior director of research. We have changed that particular survey in this iteration a little bit. Can you speak to any of the changes that you saw in that question?
We did introduce a question around the impact the pandemic specifically had. I could definitely, the actual report that Stephen mentioned does include in the appendix that a full copy of that survey, and we could follow up with you, Dr. Noland, about any changes to previous iterations of that survey.
And that specific question was meant to go out in spring of 2020, and then everything happened. And so we delayed it for a year and did make some tweaks and changes of it towards COVID.
Because my memory is the intent to enroll in post-secondary education has been right between 77 and 80% for decades. So it's if my memory is right, it's not that student intent changed. It's the follow-up question that COVID impacted that intent.
Right.
Okay, if there are no more questions, we'll take a 5-minute break. So the men's and women's rooms both are right across the atrium from where we are now. They're big trash cans if you want to get rid of your trash, and we'll see you back here at 1 o'clock.
Anthony Wise, you're wanted at the front.
Uh-oh, you're being called out.
Good afternoon. My name is Chrissy D'Alejandro. For the last 14 years, I have served as Executive Director of Tennessee Achieves, and I'm thrilled to see all of you in the room, many of which are friends. And today is an incredibly important day. We're all here, though, talking about students, so I'm already inspired that we will find a path forward. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing our panel today. I can tell you I could do this because I know so many of them, know all of them very well, but I did take notes because I'm really terrible with titles, and Linda has the longest title in higher education history, so here we go. First is Governor Bill Haslam, who will moderate today's panel. Governor Haslam served as the 49th governor of Tennessee and is known by many as the higher education governor. In my mind, his legacy will be all he did for K-12 and higher education, including, but not limited to, the Drive to 55, which resulted in nationally celebrated programs like the Tennessee Promise and Tennessee Reconnect. Before this, he served as mayor of Knoxville. I had the privilege of meeting him during this time and remember vividly asking myself after every encounter with Bill Haslam, is he actually this nice and thoughtful? Turns out after 17 years, he is, and I'm incredibly thankful for all he's done for students across Tennessee. Next is Linda Martin, who serves as the Vice President for Academic and Student Affairs for the University of Tennessee System. She also currently serves as the Interim Senior Vice President and Senior Vice Chancellor for the University of Tennessee Institute of Agriculture. Whew, yes, this is Linda, who wears many hats, more than any person I know in the higher education space. She's so intentional about student success and speaks so passionately about the importance of removing barriers for students. I'm one of her biggest fans. Next is Dr. Anthony Wise, who serves as president of Pellissippi State Community College. Anthony was appointed to this role in 2011. After serving in various other capacities in the college since he began teaching there in 1998. Anthony is a students first, always leader who, as he knows too well, results in many, many conversations with me about new thoughts and ideas. Everyone at Tennessee Achieves, including me, loves the strong relationship we have with Pellissippi State, and this starts with Anthony. And last but not certainly least is Cliff Whiteman, president of the TCAT Crossville. Cliff was appointed to this role in 2017 after beginning his journey there as a dual-enrolled student. How incredible is that? He may be the most engaged president in the country. He cares so deeply for his students and always finds a way to be relatable. He is also so much fun and actually has a fan club at Tennessee Achieves. That's a fun fact for you, Cliff. Governor, I will now turn it over to you.
Thanks. Hey, first of all, thanks for being here. This is a great room of people who care and are willing to invest time and actually solving problems. And I think most of you are like I am. We're frustrated with a world that's just divided up and yelling at each other. We'd rather be in a room full of people that actually want to solve a problem. And we have a real problem in front of us. And the data tells us that. So thank you for being here. And hopefully we'll move from looking at some data which could be a smidge depressing to talking about what can we actually do about it with some real practitioners. I'm gonna change the script real quick and just ask all of you, you just saw the PowerPoint. Any just gut reactions, like if you'd have been able to insert a voice in the middle of the presentation, anything that you have added in terms of insight from where you sit? Buddy?
I mean, I'll say in my notes that I wrote down on this morning, everything I wrote down appeared on that PowerPoint presentation. I mean, that's the reality of working at Pellissippi State and being at a community college in the state of Tennessee and many community colleges in the country right now. I mean, it's complex. There are multi-layered problems. It's going to take some real thinking and commitment to kind of flip the script back to where we've got college going rates and persistence and retention headed in the right direction again. It's gonna take digging in and doing some work.
Linda?
And I think for me, with University of Tennessee, we have lots of campuses with their very different missions and very different student populations. And so as we were going through, yes, we see that, and we see that, and we see this. And so it really brought home the importance of understanding the students that we serve and how we can address the challenges that we're facing in unique and different ways.
Yeah.
Well, with me, I always try to be ever the optimist. And, you know, higher ed has always been cyclical for years. And I think what when I look at what COVID done to higher ed, and it was at TCATS as well, I think when everybody kind of had the fear of going out and doing things, people stopped marketing as a whole. And I kind of think that's what it'll take. It'll be just that getting back out, selling it, putting it back out there, putting the word out of what higher ed does. And eventually it'll go back up on the upswing. So, I mean, I'm not so sure that it's a true problem. Well, there again, ever the optimist. I don't think it's such a true problem of what students' perception of higher ed. I just don't know if they have a true awareness of it anymore because it sort of got filtered out in the mix of everything bad.
I'll say this. I think with COVID, the consequences are going to be felt in this country for a long time to come. And I think whether that be rising fifth graders who didn't learn to read as well as they could have, should have in second or third grade, to college attendance rates, to mental health issues with young people, the impact is way broader than anyone thought. And I think one of the things that we need to do as leaders is define reality. And we're dealing with a world that has been impacted way more than what is recognized. And so that's part of what we want to do is figure that out. So, Anthony, let me just start with you. Tell me about some specific things you're doing at Pellissippi State to reverse the decline. I've known you well. You've tried to be practical all the time. Give us some ideas of things you're doing.
Yeah, to try and reverse things. So one of the things we've done the last couple of years is we've created a new department called Student Care and Advocacy. So, and this comes from a lot of the work we've done at our institution and some of the things that Tennessee Achieves has done throughout the state. So, yes, Tennessee Promise provided free tuition and mandatory fees across the system, but there are many of our students who need something beyond that. And then if you look at, you know, challenges students have with housing, we did a story this year on one of our graduates who was homeless during his 2 years with us at Pellissippi State. You know, so how do you have a mechanism in place so if you have a student who turns up and doesn't have a place to live for 3 or 4 weeks that you have a way of dealing with it? And that's what that office was really for. How do you deal with homelessness? How do you deal with students who are parents and don't have enough to feed their kids? And so the vast majority of higher education institutions now have considered food pantries to try to provide that resource. How do you have somebody who can just serve as a caseworker? And we've added a case manager into that department so that students who have really complicated problems can at least talk to somebody who has some chance of helping them deal with those problems before they walk away from their education. Because we need them to continue that pursuit to being a nurse or a welder or somebody who's going to transfer to the University of Tennessee and become a historian.
And let me back up and ask that question I meant to ask you first. Your opinion, your personal opinion, what caused the fall off? What was it? They weren't there to be pursued in high school. There's better job opportunities. Your personal opinion, what caused the fall off?
Yeah, so Pellissippi State's still the largest community college in the state of Tennessee, but we're 20% smaller than we were when this started from fall of 2019 to this particular academic year. This is different than other disruptions. I'll say, you know, slight exaggeration to say that the American Association of Community College meetings community college presidents root for small recessions because that always leads to enrollment increases. But this is very different, because you had a complex layer of problems related to public health and the level of instruction and people choosing, just as Dr. Carruthers pointed out, some are choosing not to come to campus because they don't want to be in an environment where they have to be around other people, and some, you know, who can't deal with the online environment. But if you look at the student populations that we are tracking most closely at Pellissippi State prior to the pandemic. And it was through our work with Achieving the Dream and the Board of Regents system, trying to close equity gaps, which I think you challenged us to do as you left office, you know, underrepresented students, under-resourced students, and under-prepared students. Those gaps have only gotten worse over the last 2 years. And I think the impact is going to be longstanding for institutions like Pellissippi State, we have significant numbers of students who are parents. They're not likely to return until they feel like there's stability in the primary and secondary education of their children. And we're just going to, you know, have to wait that out. And then there's this, you know, the increased rate of pay that some students can get right out of high school. So there's this opportunity cost that their decision that they're making, and maybe not a wise decision in the long run, but if they can get $17 or $19 an hour, they feel like it's the decision they want to make in the short run.
Let me jump to one of the facts that the data brought out was that the students who are desiring a four-year experience has actually increased in the midst of this. And there's some valid economic reasons for that. But one of the hopes when we started Tennessee Promise is that the pathways idea would really pick up and the folks who are going to use 2 years free and then go on two more years. And we had a lot of discussions with the 4 years at this time that this really wasn't going to hurt you, given 2 years free to community colleges. But I guess I'd love to hear your thoughts, like, how do we make certain that pathway really does exist and students are taking advantage of it?
And I think one of the things that, unpack that a little bit, because when we started Tennessee Promise, we achieved our goal of getting more students to consider two-year degree programs. But I don't know that we did a good job of helping them think about what comes next, mm-hmm. the four-year degree. And it became much more of a handoff than a handshake. Mm-hmm. And so thinking about how do we integrate with our community college partners, how do we make it seamless? And back in another life, I provided oversight at the same institution for a two-year campus and students at the four-year campus. And I know that the more integrated we could make those programs, the more interaction our faculty had across those two campuses, the more students got to see the opportunities that existed beyond that two-year experience, the ones that had that interest were successful in doing so. We know right now that there are an awful lot of students who say that they want to pursue a four-year degree after they complete their two-year and never do that. And I will say that part of that is we may not be helping them see that pathway. We may not be helping them navigate that as well as we could because somewhere along the line, we're not seeing as many of them make that
transition. So specifically, you say that we might not be. Where should that be happening better?
So I think it's both. I think the 4 years and the 2 years right now, it's 2 years do a great job. Students get the degree, and then we pick them up from there rather than really thinking about how do we integrate that interface so that we're both at the table during that transition and not just sending students on their way and saying, hey, congratulations, you've earned your two-year degree. Now you can go on to your four-year institution. But making that seamless and integrating some of the programs, you know, one of the things that I've done in past kinds of experiences is even thinking about the way that we do student development and organizations, where student organizations at the two-year and four-year do some integrated kinds of programming so that they start to see themselves in a different space and develop some of that confidence as well.
Can I throw something in?
Yeah.
Graham, I'm going to ask you to think back to that study we did with the College of Communication, right? So has that been 3 or 4 years? Pre-pandemic, I can't. Yeah. College Communication did a study of students who intend to transfer from Pellissippi State to the University of Tennessee. And one of the things that they found with students who stopped out with the AARS and didn't transfer is really they did not have an understanding that the financial aid aspect would be covered for them so that they would be financially secure in continuing that.
Thanks, Grandpa. Hey, by the way, I'm going to we're changing the rules here. If anybody has a question, even in the midst of this, go ahead and raise your hand. We'll stop, and I want this to be more of a conversation. Question or a comment. The only rule is if it's a comment, it has to be 20 seconds or less. Okay. So, but I mean that. If along the way, if somebody says something and you're like, I'd like to add something to that, or I'd like to ask a question, we'll do that. Yeah, Graham, go ahead.
Yep.
That helps. Yeah.
Well, yeah, it just made me think, because I do think so much about the high school and how much work we put into, like, the project grads and the college counselors, getting them to go visit these colleges and stuff.
are we getting those Pellissippi students to come do the tours at a UT and stuff like that, or is it just kind of this assumption they know what to do? Because I think there is a lot of hand-holding from high school into whichever college, but I don't know if we do that, like I was saying, from transition from 2 year to 4 year.
Yeah, so actually there are a number, at Pellissippi State, there are a number of four-year institutions that actually have an ongoing presence on our campus, including the University of Tennessee and East Tennessee State University, among others. So there's actually somebody there on campus who can speak to students who are thinking about that transfer and ready to make that. But as Graham mentioned, they usually tend to be on the admissions side and not necessarily on the financial aid side. Hmm. So I don't know how deep those conversations about, because again, I kind of do my own formal in-serving, talking to students in line at commencement saying, you know, what's your degree in? What are you planning to do next? You can go into the workforce, your transfer. And you do get those students like, well, I finished my General Associates of Arts. I'm just going to take a year or two. And that's probably not the best for their long-term bachelor's degree completion if that's their intended path.
I'd like to also add those students, the two-year, four-year transfer students. You know, you think about a first-time, full-time freshman at our four-year institutions. When they come to campus, everybody's standing on the curb clapping, we're glad you're here, here's what you do. And we have all these orientations, and we have programmatic kinds of things to help them feel connected to the campus community and learn what needs to be done to be successful. Our transfer students don't come necessarily in a group. And so they come, they show up, they look around. And many times they think they know how to navigate a college campus, but we put them in an environment that's very different, and we don't provide that support to really help them be successful.
Can I build on something you said? So when we talk about those seamless transfer pathways, you hit on the start of it. I think it all starts with the high schools. If you get the counselors vested in that career path for that student, and we create those, like that career cluster that is used in K-12, I hope nobody in K-12 is in here, it's confusing, because about the time you understand it, something changes.
We do have a few K-12 people here, but go ahead.
I just
a little warning.
I kind of thought so. This is what I'm known for. So, you know, we've always...
Is that where that fan club comes from that Chrissy was talking about?
Well, what we've always, the thought is there is surely somewhere in the career cluster that we can see that we can implant a welding, say within ag mechanics and things of that nature that may not be exactly identified in that cluster, but that, you know, heck, if we can get them 50 hours at a TCAT that transfers to Pellissippi, that transfers to UT, when a student sees that all the way in, plus the counselor, and the big thing is the parent. If they see that chain going right from K-12, right into TCAT, right into community college, right on into four-year school, that's your best cheering squad there. I mean, that's the one that's going to make sure everybody shows up to everything and make sure that everybody enters well. So that was a good observation of that.
I'm going to leave you on. Tell us, TCATs are a little different than 2 years or 4 years. Tell us what the environment's been like there in the midst of coming out of COVID and some things that you are working on to get us past the current situation.
It was an interesting thing that throughout COVID, we never lost at TCAT Crossville. Some did, but we actually gained.
Now, let me stop. Why?
Well, because of, I guess, of how TCAT's been somewhat different. What we done, we had a very unique approach, and I can't speak for all TCATs, but so when the mandated lockdown came, of course, that was when we all really had the time to put on thinking cap. How can we best serve these students in an environment that is not indicative to that distance type learning? So, for instance, in Diesel. So how do you work with that? So what we did, we reached out at our advisory committees, all programs in TCATs have advisory committees. That was the first ones we hit on. That was one of the biggest jobs that I was doing. We called all of these, you know, everybody from legal offices, from our administrative, all the way into, like I said, the Diesel, into the welding crews, any industry that we had contacts with. TCATs have the co-op programs, which are work-based learning type. So industry never slowed down. Some did in some aspects, but as a rule, industry never slowed down. So I guess the way we looked at it is, well, these people that are in industry are generally TCAT alumni, so they know what we do. We give those the curriculum to them. They, in a sense, became the instructors in the work-based learning. Our instructors were keeping in contact with the alumni and the lead people in these facilities, but the student the whole time never lost any continuity. It was always, always on a learning process. And as far as the online, that was something that I know definitely at RTCAT that we had to learn about very quickly. A lot of the trades instructors, that was something that was sort of foreign. But, you know, we adapted. It's just that's what TCATs do. That's what we all do. You just overcome and move on. But, you know, we did some very unique things, definitely with our industry partners and putting those students out in those work-based learning opportunities, as well as the distancing. Gosh, we called industry partners. Instead of having a instructor training with one engine, we may have had a industry, like, for instance, Nissan. Nissan, one phone call. How many engines do you need? So we went back to the old days. Everybody remember the old Google glasses, the old projection glasses? Instructors working on one engine that's projecting on the screen. All the other students had those same engines where they were before. They may have been clustered around the instructor. Well, now they each had their own project going on. You know, it was just we done what we had to do, and so we never really slowed down. We actually gained. The data did show an interesting thing with us. We are now seeing a decline in one area, and that's practical nursing. And as a strange phenomenon, of course, in Cumberland County, of course, we're a large retirement population. So practical nursing has always been very, very strong for us. So, you know, all of us that's in education, you may want to put your cards to that side. Well, I think what has happened, when you see like us, we were at a huge uptick and never lost students, but now we're at a 3% decline. Well, that's because over a third of the students on the campus were in practical nursing. And all of a sudden, none of them want to go to work. And we're not seeing any enrollment in those programs. So that's one that we're definitely have to contend with right now. Trying to, you know, we're no different from anybody else. We're trying to figure out why. I'm sure it's fear of that. And for the other thing is the wages. CNAs now make, in some cases, what LPNs were. Mm-hmm. And LPNs are making what RNs were. And it's, you know, it's hard to contend with that. But it's, you know, we'll figure it out some way.
Let me ask a little bit. One of the concerning pieces of the data is who we're missing, and a little bit that we've been working on the equity gaps in Tennessee for a long time. Unfortunately, COVID has caused us to go backwards. So what can we do? I mean, our focus on first-generation students, on students of color, we're struggling even more than we have historically. What can we do about those two populations specifically, first-generation students and students of color? Anthony, you want to go first?
I was hoping somebody else had the answer. So here's some things we're trying to at Pellissippi State. So one, we're doing a focus on coaching and like how you build a coaching model college-wide. And we picked some of this up, visited, how do you get the sense? Well, we had commencement a few weeks ago, and every student who walks across the stage at commencement, whether it's at the TCAT or a community college or a four-year university, they can tell you who the three or four people are that help them get to that point. It might be the person who sells them their Chick-fil-A sandwich. It might be their economics professor. It might be their coach. It might be a mentor, a peer, somebody on the staff. But they can name those people. The challenge is that we haven't built those intentional structures in for all of our students. So that's one of the things we're focusing on at Pellissippi State. Who's the person you're going to have a relationship with at the college, and how can they then refer you to the other supports that you need at the institution? So this is your coach. They're going to connect you to your person in financial aid. They're going to connect you to your person in advising. They're going to connect you to student care and advocacy if you get to a point where you don't feel like you can continue at school. But these people are going to be on your team because every successful college or university student has them. We just haven't built them into the system and the structure. So we're being very intentional about shifting our employee base into having more people do that work. I think we've got to do a better job. You talk about pathways have come up a couple times. So how do you fully integrate those within the high school, the TCAT? We're seeing more and more examples of that with the universities. So, you know, our new facility in Blount County is a partnership with TCAT Knoxville. And a lot of the idea around it, that is, let's not compete in the same space, say like mechatronics or engineering technology. Let's figure out a way to ladder the curricula of those programs, that a student might be a CTE student who transfers to, does dual enrollment with TCAT Knoxville, that comes into Pellissippi State, and maybe decides to get a Bachelor of Applied Science at some point down the road, laddering those opportunities. And then on the employment front, something we've tried this year at Pellissippi State is we created something we call the Student Employment Project. So we went out and paid our own $15 an hour salary for students on campus, with the thought behind this is if we could hold them on campus and place them in an area that was somewhat related to their career interest, pay them a good wage that would prevent them from going out and looking for two or three service sector jobs, that there was some kind of mentorship and some professional development associated with that. So we don't really have the data on that yet. We'll pull that and see. But we think that's a strategy for first-gen, low-income students of color in terms of creating, again, another sort of safe space on campus where they can build some networking connections.
Perfect. Linda?
I'd like to also add, for example, our veteran students, our adult students, and students or learners who have completed some college credits and for whatever reason have not returned. Mm-hmm. And I think those are really good populations that we need to think about, because we've done fairly well in the traditional college age space, but thinking about how we continue to attract other learners. And for us, it's wraparound services. It's thinking about using data analytics much more purposefully. I think I couldn't say enough about that. We're a long way from being where we want to be, but any investment that we are able to make in data analytics to help with student success, retention, persistence to degree, attracting students back to higher education is well worth the investment. The other thing that we learned during COVID is the need our students have, and particularly it became evident in the area of mental health and well-being, but really in all areas of counseling, academic advising, is we did a good job of delivering those services, the advising services, from 8 to 5. But our students don't need those answers just from 8 to 5. And so thinking about how do we create a 24/7 model for students to be able to access resources, and also it allows us to provide the opportunity for our employees to have maybe a more flexible work schedule themselves, because somebody has to be on at 10 o'clock at night or at 11 o'clock at night to answer those questions, which means that they don't have to be at 8 in the morning if their work schedule can be altered. So I think there's a lot of things that the pandemic taught us. There were some things that we were able to deliver. Probably we made much better use of telemedicine, telehealth, telecounseling. And so there were some things that the pandemic taught us that we could do as well or better, or needed to do in combination. And so just thinking about how do we continue, and you heard about the in-person, some wanted in-person, some didn't want in-person. One of the things that we found is students wanted the flexibility. They wanted in-person, they wanted face-to-face, they wanted it during the questions answered during the normal day, they wanted it at questions answered at 11 o'clock at night. So the challenge is, how do we deliver?
Perfect. Anything in terms of focusing on our lower income
with us, I think one of the, and there again, TCATs operate a little bit differently. With us, I think one of our biggest assets at trying to bring students that fit in those categories to the campus are the employers. The employers are the first ones that recognize that need. So when the employers start developing different things and literature and things and working within high schools, that just naturally feeds back to us. But within the TCAT system itself, well, in the TBR system, Dr. Lemming is here. We're part of the Achieving a Dream Network. And, you know, with TCATs, I'll be honest, it's always been, we don't really care who you are, what you've been, what you've done, you know, even especially on the people that's coming out of institutions, which I know that you were a big proponent of. When skilled trades, it was always cool because it doesn't matter. Nobody cares what you've done, where you've come from. All they want to know is this.
Can you do it?
Yeah. And so we rely a lot of that from the employers themselves doing their own marketing, which draws students to us. So
we're going to move a little bit more into lightning round. Let me ask everybody a hard one. If you look at the data, the fall off has primarily been in males. Why is that, and what can we do about it? Simple one. Linda, go ahead.
So I
I'm part of the problem, Linda.
So it is a tough one, and you know, there are a lot of theories out there. I have my own, but I think sometimes that I know that we need to be much more intentional about the examples that we put in front of young students. And one of the things that I focused on when I was when I wore a dean's hat is really thinking about how do we keep that male-female ratio fairly balanced. And I looked at places where it had been it had skewed far in one direction. And then I started to study, and we didn't have, for example, ambassadors were all females. Club organization officers, all females. Tutors in the tutoring center, all females. So becoming very intentional about getting males into those roles and helping them be successful, but also having a student who, so a young male student who needs a tutor, who is interested in being an ambassador, who might like to do some of those leadership roles, has a mentor. It's not just about males, it's about all of our students. If you don't see somebody who looks like you, it's hard imagining being there and doing those activities.
Perfect. Remember, you can question or comment anywhere along the way, anybody in the group. Yes, sir.
I stood next to the door in case I have to run out of here, given the audience. But I think there's some hidden males, Governor, because we have the opposite program. We, during this decline, apprenticeships in the state of Tennessee reached their highest level in history.
Okay.
Most of them are males. And so attracting females to those apprenticeship programs and the teacher apprenticeship program will help to do that. But there's some hidden data in here, and we would consider, this is where I need you to get out of the way so I can run out of here. We would consider
block him.
We would consider an apprenticeship program as a post-secondary program. And maybe it's involved with a higher education institution, maybe it's not. Anthony, I wonder about your non-credit. I bet you that's going up, and most of those are probably males.
Interesting.
So I think there's some hidden data in here, and I've had more than my 20 seconds, so I'm going to give that back to you.
No, that's good.
Well, I think that's both ways. For areas where it's been predominantly male, I think it's important for young women to have role models and the other way around.
I mean, I do think, Commissioner, there's something in that. So when I started at Pellissippi State 24 years ago and would advise students, you know, nearly everybody who graduated from Pellissippi State at that time did so by completing blocks of 3 and 4 hour credits that added up to 61 or 62 so that they got awarded an associate degree and then entered the workforce or transferred to the university. I think as my career moves into its next phase, I mean, that's going to happen less and less. It's going to be a combination of this person's done an apprenticeship somewhere. They've done a work-based learning program. They're bringing a diploma in from TCAT Knoxville. That's a big chunk. They take some 3 and 4 hour courses, but we're going to begin to construct degrees in different ways and have different sorts of outcomes. There still needs to be a lot of work on how you get balance in that. You know, how do you get male students to go into nursing and female students to go into engineering, and how do you create the right kind of visual representation of what that looks like in terms of a career? But I think that's one of the opportunities on the table is how we think about integration from middle school through our high schools into our technical college, community college, university, and then into the workforce and creating those pipelines that are not just blocks of 3 and 4 hour credits, but blocks of learning that get translated into degrees and certifications.
With us, of course, we're predominantly male. That's one of our big hurdles is bringing trying to lure the female into the male dominated. Linda, you hit it ahead. We have some of the best success stories of females that are alumni. That, for example, the one that always comes to mind, if anybody's around TCAT Crossville, I'll always say it. We had a young lady that actually came out of the Dolan Road early childhood program that we had, came in and wanted to be a welder. It's like, awesome. This is the one, you know, that's going to be a success. So she comes through, goes through our welding program. We hooked her up with a trade union that she ended up working in the North Sea, you know, making high six-figure salary. So she comes back to help recruit female students into welding. We see that all the time. So, yeah, we don't really see a lot. We're still male-dominated. That's something we're trying to get away from. Yeah. It's just hard to chisel out.
All right.
With all due respect to the apprenticeship program, but another trend that we all should be aware of is the labor participation rate of males. So I just was looking up a stat. I don't know that this is exactly right, but it said 50 years ago, male participation rate was 80%, and now it's down to 69%. I read something recently that was much lower than that. But the fact is, males are just participating less in the workforce as well as going to college.
Yeah, I think there is something bigger going on than just post-secondary in our culture. I think you're exactly right. All right, we're going to move into, I'm going to ask you, I'm going to tell you the last two questions. I'll give you both of them up front, okay? But they're not hard ones.
Do you get to pick?
Yeah, no, you know, you get both. But one at a time, okay? So the first one's this. Tell me something that's really working right now. And you, I know you all have touched on some things, but I want from everybody, tell me something that's really working that others in this room can steal, okay? And the second is, you get to be in charge, you get to be czar for a day and change anything, okay? Now, it has to be realistic. It can't be, you know, this isn't science fiction. Like, if it's a policy or a procedure or something, you get to change something to make it, to address the problem. What's that going to be? So first one is, tell me something that's really working. Second, you don't have to, it doesn't have to go through the legislature, it doesn't have to go through county commission, it doesn't have to go through anything, okay? The governor doesn't have to approve it. What, tell me something you'd do. Okay, so I'm going to start down here. Tell me something that's really working right now that the rest of us can steal.
So with us, obviously I go back to our industry partners. With TCATS, I think a lot of time when you see data where TCATS enrollment hasn't rose any, it's because the campuses are saturated. And especially with TCATS Crossville, we have a huge wait list. Governor Lee's done a great job of helping us eliminate a lot of those programs. But physical space is an issue.
Right.
So what we've done, we actually learned this from COVID, of how receptive our industry partners were at bringing in these students into work-based learning. So what that does, we're sending all these students out on this work-based learning and even hire people to monitor those. At the same time, we're enrolling new students to fill those seats. So that's working with us very well. As far as the other, if I was czar...
No, you're going to come back. We're doing one at a time. I'm going to let you think about it for two more. I'm going to give you two more minutes. Linda.
So I think we're just thinking much more intentionally about the student experience and the co-curricular and the classroom piece to help students understand that the learning doesn't stop when they leave the classroom door, and thinking very intentional about learning outcomes associated with the co-curricular and other kinds of experiences our students are having. And I think that's really helpful for them to think about the full range of educational opportunities that they have, whether it's high impact practices, undergraduate research, those kinds of things. And then I think about stronger partnerships among our UT institutions, coming together and using the unique talents, the unique expertise that exists across our campuses. It's not a reason why it can't work outside of UT, and leveraging that rather than working against one another, because we all have the same endpoint in mind, and that's to help Tennessee get more students with credentials.
Well said. Anthony.
Big proponent of those co-curricular pathways and well-defined. But I'll say for my response, that combination of coaching and either emergency fund / completion grants, all the data shows that students who take advantage of those are persisting and retaining at a much higher level. So how do we do that at scale and with some fidelity across the state to make sure, again, students who have expressed the desire to be at an institution have the support and the resources they need to see it through?
Perfect.
We can't let them walk away.
Perfect. All right, now you get the czar for a day.
Mine may have to require some legislative action. You'd be a good one to take up the gavel on that. So with us, the big thing that we see...
I'm not a registered lobbyist, sorry.
The big thing that we see that's always, I mean, obviously Tennessee Promise, Tennessee Reconnect were huge for TCATS. But I think the thing that everybody forgets is, especially with TCATS, not so much the books, but it's the tools. The tools are costly. I mean, students that come in to I could just start diesel, obviously comes to mind, auto tech. Those, we want those students to have all of those tools ready to go when they graduate the program, because that's a draw for an employer.
Makes sense.
See a student graduate and they've got all the tools they're in. I mean, physical tools, that's a plus for the student. That's almost like a portfolio build itself. If I was czar for a day, I would figure out somehow to take, if there's any excess money and anything to do with Tennessee Achieves, to make it to where tools could be bought. I mean, the tuition is great. That's great.
Limit's coming.
Okay.
We had $14.5 million in the budget, so every Pell eligible.
And you didn't call and tell me? So so I'm breathing a sigh of relief now. Yeah, cool.
At least for Pell eligible Tennessee Promise students, it doesn't take care of everybody, but any student under that umbrella will have access in the mall.
So I'm a happy man.
As you wish. As you wish. All right. Just out of curiosity for those in this audience, what are the set of tools for a diesel? What are we talking about?
A graduate-level diesel mechanic, if you go all the way through to the torque wrenches, it's required about $6,000.
Okay. Nice. All right, that's helpful. No.
Do I get two? May I have two?
You can.
Okay, thank you. The one is pretty easy, and that is figuring out ways to promote reverse transfer more across the state. We have a lot of students who never get their 2-year degree who have earned the coursework, and it's because they opt in. They're not automatically in. They have to opt into the program. And so if there was a way to do some data mining so that when a student was achieve that those credentials that they automatically receive that degree rather than having to apply and to go through the degree audit and everything, it would be amazing. I think we would have a lot more students with a 2-year credential. And then building on that,
those primarily people that are at 4 years.
So they started at a 2-year and they left prior to earning their 2-year degree. So they came to the 4-year and they're working toward their 4-year degree, some of whom graduate, others who don't, but they never transfer the hours back. And so the two-year programs, and we have a really good system in Tennessee, unlike other places, where we have incentives to work together, because there's not a disincentive for you to send a student forward if we're able to do that reverse transfer.
Is that a legislative issue or a data issue?
It's a data issue.
Okay, I thought so. Okay.
The other one is thinking about how we create multiple pathways to credentials. So, for example, a student at a TCAT that might leave before they're completed, do we have certificates of modules where they're certified in certain areas and they can promote that? And I think the answer to that is yes. But using that in terms of, for example, our 2-year institutions, and I used to oversee a 2-year institution where a lot of our really good students got hired before they earned their 2-year degree. But working with employers, kind of in a PLA, a prior learning assessment kind of thing, if you go to this employer and you complete these credentials, then we'll transfer those back. So working on those agreements with potential employers to make that happen before the student ever leaves. And then the last one is thinking about those students who come to our 4-year institutions who complete 2 years of work. They didn't come seeking a 2-year degree, but they came and completed 2 years of work. It may be, in some cases, the same 2 years that they completed at a 2-year institution and earned the degree. They leave the four-year degree institution without a credential. And so how do we work? How do we figure that out? How do we help students have a credential, even if they're not completing in the pathway that we traditionally see?
That's a good one.
All right. Seems frivolous to waste this on having a fan club like Cliff Whiteman, so I'll try and come up with something better than that. Amen on the reverse transfer piece. We've got a lot of good structure in place in Tennessee, but it could be much more seamless, and I think it'd be beneficial to students. Mine kind of builds on Linda's answer. Really having a fully integrated educational system from middle school through the university, and what I mean by that is, you know, having some good conversation with families and children about 8th grade and 9th grade, and I think we'll see some of this with 865 academies here in Knox, and there are other examples about it throughout the state. Really thinking about what those early post-secondary learning opportunities are and some intentionality built into that, but it's got to be fully integrated with the workforce. We do so many things at Pellissippi State with the great employers we have in the region, but they're for 5 people or 10 people or 7 people or 3 people. And if we really can figure out a way of integrating, apprenticeship and internship and other work-based learning opportunities and truly making those connections between those educational pathways and the career opportunities that exist in the region and the state.
Right. I'm going to throw it up into the audience. Anybody? Yes.
Early in the program, when you were doing the data analysis, childcare was mentioned 4 to 6 times. Mm-hmm. Not one of you have mentioned childcare when you talk about how you might impact your students going forward.
Did
Just a quick advertorial, the UT Health Science Center just opened a daycare on our campus in Memphis. I think it's a trend that we'll see more of. But you're right, if we're going to reach working adults, we're going to have to be able to provide them the kind of services that they need.
It's one of the things that we provide through our student care and advocacy opportunities to connect to. It's something we've had conversations probably for 15 years about how to do it on campus. We just haven't figured out how to crack that nut yet. It's a huge issue, and it may be more of an issue in the last 2 years than it's ever been before.
And in my comment relative to adult learners and those that have some college credit and are returning, that's going to be one of the key components to attracting those students. So as I say, thinking about the needs of those students, child care is right at the top of the list.
Yeah, it's no different with us. It's the same. You know, with us, I think that the awareness of what a student is when they're entering the TCAT, that's one of the first things we mentioned. Make sure that you get your child care issues taken care of. But it is definitely, that's one, I guess I should have thrown that in with my tools. That would have been a good one.
All right, the audience, just for either one of the questions, number one, tell us something that's working right now, number one, or number two, you get to be czar, what would you do? Please.
So the class of the high school class of 2020, if they didn't go to college, they don't have access to a traditional Tennessee Promise, and they're not going to be old enough for Tennessee Reconnect. The legislature moved the age for Reconnect down a little bit. They moved the age for non-traditional Hope down a little bit, but they're still not going to be there for a couple more years. I think a concerted effort to get 2 years of free college to the class of 2020 specifically could help change some minds for some folks who put college off because they didn't want to take it online or because they couldn't given the circumstances.
Can I answer? They actually had access to
The 2020 cohort did have access to an additional year of eligibility for Tennessee Promise. There were about 19,000 students that fell into that category who had applied for Tennessee Promise and not followed through. And we bombarded them, just borderline harassed them trying to get them back. And we got 527 of them back. And so I think the value proposition conversation has to be had with that particular cohort. So the funding is there, but is that enough of a carrot to bring them back? I think that's the big question.
That's great.
Tim. What percentage of the 47% that don't attend college, what percentage of those are just not ready for college? They just didn't do well enough in high school.
I'll, somebody have access to that data? I don't know if that's...
Of those that don't attend? Well, I mean, I can say, I mean, of those that do attend a community... You know, John?
Yeah, but I'm just trying to think through the questions. So those who... I guess defining who didn't do well in high school. So we have about a 90% graduation rate. So there's probably about 10% that I would say probably fall under that category on an annual basis. So I don't really know like what percentage, like what happens to that 10%, if that's kind of the question. But it does piggyback nice to my comment. Can I do that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, good. So thanks for the question. I really don't have that data. But something Anthony alluded to a minute ago was and I've heard that engagement of families early on is critically important. So something that we think has promised to work is the 865 academies that Anthony talked about. And really that's in Knox County, that's our attempt to reimagine high schools and middle schools from 6 through 12 really in a more comprehensive way, thinking long term. What does it mean? It's not enough for us to have people cross the stage. Like, that's not success for us. It's once they cross, can they be successful in that next step? And we think that needs to happen for every student. It's not just set up for, you know, those who ask the questions or have someone who can advocate and ask those questions. So kind of the concept real quick is that that we have a robust system from 6 through 12 that does aptitude testing, that does career exposure, and even allows our high schools to kind of have academy structure so that we have career tech ed exposure along with advanced academic exposure for every student. So when they do come out, they're making informed decisions based on their experiences and for what's best for them for their future. So again, 7 of our high schools are doing that next year in the process of that, but we think it's got a good way to engage families for the future.
Can I follow? The reason I asked the question, it seems like at some point, in the counseling for our kids that some career choices need to be made, or the kids should be pushed in a career direction. If they're not going to be ready for college when they graduate, and I think you know that about the eighth grade, most kids, if they're not going to be ready for college by the time they graduate, they need to be pushed in a direction where Cliff can help these kids, because the future's not very bright if they don't get into a career or college some way.
I think we would agree on this end of that we want to make sure we never limit a student that they have those opportunities. But I think the great thing about that is it's not an either or, right? So you have those multiple exits that you can take. So if a student does have that exposure and industry certifications and they're being successful, we want to encourage that so that they're employable when they leave high school. In the same way, sometimes students turn things around 2 years in, 3 years in, and we want to make sure they have that exposure to everything for when they graduate so they can do that. So I think this allows both to happen.
Randy, yeah, make one comment and just kind of build on something that Linda said, and something we've been talking about at UT a lot, but we haven't quite executed on yet. We've been talking about college going rates. It's all about going to college and buying one of our three products, a 1 year, a 2 year, or a 4 year degree. You can learn anything you want as long as you're willing to buy it in those increments. And really what we're talking about is giving our students some marketable skills after high school. And what it says it has to be in 1 year, 2 year, 4 year increments. So what we need to be thinking about, I think, in post-secondary education is what other units of wisdom can we sell to our students? And maybe it's a 12-week certificate, maybe it's a 6-month certificate, but finding new products. If we were a business and people stopped buying our product, we would start coming up with new products. But we just keep trying to sell the same thing. And we need to find ways to create new units of measure that offer value to our students.
And I think multiple start times too. We tend to start the semester all at the same time. And even though we do short chunks, we do it within the semester block. So thinking about a rolling start time and then making better use of our summers. In many cases, our campuses sit empty. And so how do we intentionally use that summertime to bring cohorts or really engage young people in considering multiple opportunities?
Virginia.
Let me think about this. My daughter has been over in Prague this semester, and she brought up that a bunch of Ukrainian students came over, and one thing that was very beneficial about her university was it was on a semester system, but then they had certain classes that were very intense for a week. So it worked for these Ukrainian kids that came over mid-semester, but it was kind of a cool way that she got some classes, you know, checked off in one week. Huh. They would get an entire semester worth done, which just made me think about what you're saying, is it's many alternatives. Like most of her classes were semester long, but there were ways to get credits just in 1 week's time.
And some of what we're doing with the online is making it the second half of the semester. So if a student starts a traditional face-to-face semester-long course and runs into difficulty, they could plug into that half semester and still stay on track to graduation with the right amount of tutoring and assistance to be successful.
Yes, sir. We'll get your mic.
So one of the things that I think could help more students get into college is lowering that sticker price, because earlier in the presentation when it showed that the cost of college was flat or even declining, I didn't know that. I remember 4 years ago when I was still in high school, I would literally have cold sweats at night thinking about, oh my God, how am I going to be able to afford college? If there's any ways in which we can, you know, make that affordability more prevalent, I think that will help get more people through the door.
All right. Anybody got 30 seconds? Yes.
I have a question. Can you talk a little bit about what this declining college going rate might, the effects that it might have on our workforce development?
Yeah, I'll take that one. I think it's, I mean, the reason we started Drive to 55 10 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, 9 years ago was that we were really worried about whether we would have the right workforce. 55% of the jobs were going to require a degree or certificate, and we were at like 32 or 33% then. And so we knew we had to address that. That's while it's short term, it feels like it might have changed. You know, I can go out and get a hourly job for $15 an hour now. That feels great. the limits of that are still true. I mean, it's still, you know, the jobs that you can make above $45,000 without a degree or certificate are still like really limited. And then the jobs that we're recruiting to Tennessee are more and more requiring a higher skill set. I mean, one of the things you do when you run for office is you visit a lot of employers. And every time I was taken by how few workers were needed to produce a lot of product, but how highly trained they needed to be. And it's just going to keep going that way. And so, fortunately, we're going to still need diesel mechanics and welders, but there's a lot of jobs that are going to fall off, and we just hadn't felt that yet. And my last thought is the declining birth rates means that companies right now are spending more time than ever thinking, how can I automate this? So I just think that trend is going to escalate. All right, I am committed to getting us out on time. I think I'm supposed to. Let me just say one last thing. I honestly think leadership starts with defining reality. It's one of the things I appreciate about the data that comes out of the Boyd Center that Dr. Fox and others have led. But if we can in this country start focusing on what's the data actually tell us about the problem and then talk about solutions, we can be at a better place. So thank you all for being a part of that. And thank you, Marianne, for hosting us.
Thank you for being here. Okay, so I'm going to close this out with three instructions. Get your parking validated, drop your name tag, pick up a chocolate bar. Those are your three instructions. Let's do a last round of applause for all of our panelists.
Well done. That was great. You were great. That was fun.
Absolutely.
They did a nice job. That was good.
Nice
job. That was right here. I'll get your good hand. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. And we can pull it together in a single.
We all did well.
In a single business.